Again, welcome to ITCO 299 class. That's Comprehensive Project Management course at ARU Online. In these lectures, we're going to cover architectural views. So our main objective is why software architectural, what is a software architectural, and also different types of software architecture and their levels. We're also going to cover introduction to architectural documentation. So first, we start with why software architectural. The main reason why we need a software architectural because we know softwares are mostly a complex system or a complex entity. So in order to develop a software, again, we first need to design, analyze it, and understand all the components. So software architectural view is a concept of software modeling. We need to come up with different diagrams, design the system. We have a special tool which we use in software engineering course, which is called a Unified Modeling Language, UML. It consists of 13 different diagrams that we can use to develop, again, a software architectural view or a modeling. And we may discuss that. So, for example, here, we are going to build a doghouse. Now, to build a doghouse, we don't need to design it because, again, a doghouse is a very small house. It doesn't require electricity, much components or elements. So this can be built by one person. So this means it requires only minimal modeling, or possible there's no need of modeling it. Also, the process will be very simple, and also we are going to use the simple tools. Now, if we are going to develop a very large mansion, this require a lot of elements or components, such as the lighting system, many doors. In a doghouse, we need only one door. Maybe we don't even need a window, or we need only one window. By building a mansion like this, we may need maybe more than 10, 20 windows, different doors. So in this case, we need to design the house, which we normally call the blueprint. We design the house to know which window is best at what position, what doors are best, the kitchen where it should be. So there are so many components. So this is the main reason why we need architectural view in software development process, because since the software is a very complex and large system, first we need to design it. So here we said that it's most efficiently and timely by a team if we again design it first, get a blueprint of it. Also, it require modeling, a well-defined process, and also a power tools. So the differences between different types of again a software modeling system can be the scaling, and also the process, and the cost. Some software project may be larger or more expensive than others. Also, the schedules. We may need the different skills and development teams. For example, if you want to design a software for gaming and gaming system, most likely we need different skills and development tools than developing a system for business application, let's say accounting system, inventory monitoring system. Materials and technology will be different. Also, we need to be concerned about the stakeholders, and also the risks involved may be different. So next, we are going to discuss now what is a software architecture. Now we understand why we need software architecture, again, for modeling process and designing process. So we have a definition for a software architecture, or architecture in short. Here we say a software architecture is what software architects do. Now, according to IEEE 1471 2000, a software architecture is the fundamental organization of a system embodied in its components. Since again, a software system may have more than one component, we can refer it as classes, more than 120, 100 of classes. So there are relationships also to each other and the environment, and also the principles governing its design and evolution. We also have different definition for software architecture. Here, according to Perry and Wolf, 1992, a set of architectural or design elements that have a particular form. Also, according to Boehm et al. 1995, a software system architecture comprises of the following: one, a collection of software and system components and their connections and their constraints. And also a collection of system stakeholders' need statements. This is why in our Unit 3 assignment, we come up with two architectural views. Then also the question says we should list five requirements. The requirement is very important. And we shall explain what we mean by software requirement. So a rationale also which demonstrate that the components, connections, constraints define the system that if implemented, it will satisfy the collection of system stakeholders' need statements. So this is the concept of a requirement. A requirement is the need of the system. For example, we have a functional requirement and we have non-functional requirement. Functional requirement is the task that the system will perform. So that will be the stakeholders' need statement. The non-functional requirement can be the quality of the system. For example, is it well secured? Is it faster? Is it durable, robust? We consider all this as non-functional requirement. Also, according to Kremert et al. 1997, a software architecture of a program or computing system is the structure or structures of the system, which comprises software components, the external visible properties of those components, and their relationship among them. Now, when we look at all the definitions we went through, somewhere around four of them, they all have one thing in common. A software architectural view is a design tool. We use it to model our system. As we said in earlier time, if we are going to develop a very simple system, there's no need of architectural views. If it's a complex system, then we need it. So architectural defines major components. Also, architectural defines component relationship or their structures and also their interactions. That's why in a UML diagram, we have what we call the CRAS diagram. Now, most likely we always develop a system using object-oriented programming, such as Java, Python, C++. So the component of a system, the major component will be the CRASes. A very simple example, if I'm going to design a system that will monitor, let's say the video rental store, the two major, or at least the three major CRASes I'm going to identify will be the item, in this case, the video or DVD class. What are the properties of DVDs and what are the behavior of a DVD? Maybe renting, that is giving out, coming in, counting, and the properties can be the title of the DVD, the duration of the DVD, the octets, etc. Now, another class I can identify will be customers, because customers are going to interact with the DVD, and also employees, because employees are going to interact with the DVD also. So that is the concept here. Architecture would defines the component relationship and also the major components. Again, object-oriented programming, our major component will be the classes. Also, architecture omits content information about component that does not pertain to the interaction. So if we don't need it, we have to remove it. Now, the behavior of a component is part of the architecture insofar as it can be discerned from point of view of another component. Now, every system also has an architecture, even a system composed of one component. A very simple system, we can come up with the modeling of it. Example was the doghouse. If we want, we can have it, but since it's very simple, most likely we don't need to. Also, architecture defines the rationale behind the components and their structure. Also, architectural definition do not define what a component is. Architecture is a single structure. No single structure is the architecture. So again, architecture is not a single structure. And also, no single structure is the architecture. Next, let's go through the architectural drives. Here we say the architecture serves as the blueprint for the system. So architecture is again more or less a modeling system. As we start with the earlier example, building a mansion, a house, I need a blueprint first before I start. I'll know where each component of the mansion will be, the elements such as the kitchen, the bathroom, the living room, etc. So we may have the team structure, documentation organization, also work breakdown structure. Work breakdown structure will list all the activities or the tasks that we need to perform in order to develop the system. So the schedule is important, planning, budgeting, and also unit testing, integration, testing also. So architecture normally will establish the communication and also the coordination mechanism among components. So now, what's the difference between architecture and design? Here we say the architecture is where the non-functional decisions are cast. Non-functional decisions are cast, and also functional requirements are partitioned. But in the design, this is where the functional requirements are accomplished. Well, this is design is the process of again coming up with a product, but in this case, not using the tool, for example, Java or C++ programming language, not yet. But we can design the algorithm, the elements, etc. that we need for the system. So here we say with the architecture, we have non-functional requirements. Then with the design, we have functional requirement. Functional requirement will be dealing with the domains. Now, system quality attributes is very important. For example, these are mostly the non-functional requirements. The performance of the system, maybe it will depend on the speed, availability, usability, security. These are non-functional requirements pertaining to the end user's view. End user, the person using the system, always want the system to perform well, always want the system to be available, not to shut down, break down. The usability, maybe easy to use, security, very important. Now, in terms of developers' view, maintainability is important because they are the ones going to maintain the system. They make sure that the system is portable. So portability, reusability, testability. Now, time to market. This is for business community view. The cost and benefit, projected lifetime, target market. So the goal for end user is the performance. Is the system available, usable, secured? Now, with developers' view, maintainability is the issue. Is it portable, reusable, testability? Then business will be dealing with the time to market, profit. So cost and benefit, projected lifetime. Then targeted market, integration with legacy system, rollback schedule. Now, next, we're going to talk about software architectural types and their levels. So in terms of business architecture, we are going to be concerned with the business model as it related to automated solution. So example, a e-business is a good candidate, or the structural part of a requirement analysis, also the domain specific. In terms of technical architecture, here we have to be more specific to what technology we are using, the type of technology, and also the use of this technology to structure the technical points. Here we use the term technology mapping of an architecture. So example can be .NET or JTEE or hardware architects. Also solution architecture. Here we say the specific to a particular business area or the project, but still we need to rely on being a technical focal point for communication between the domain architect, business interests, and also development. The last session, we're going to discuss about different types of architectural documentation. So here we have the architectural structure and views. Now in construction, there are blueprints, as we mentioned earlier, for a plan, or different side of a construction, electrical wiring, plumbing, if we are building a house. Each of these views specify a single entity. I'm building a house, I may have a design for electricals, design for the foundation, and design for the plumbing system, etc. Now, each of these views specify a single entity from different perspective. Now, because used by different person for a different goal. Now, similarly, there are different structures and views also in software architecture. So, view is a representation of software architecture based on the structure as written by the architect and also read by the stakeholders. So, we have the common one is 4+1 views of architecture. And this is where our assignment is focused on. So, we have logical view. In logical view, we can talk about the classes. Here, we may have the class diagrams. And they are also their interfaces. And then we have a collaborations. A collaboration diagram will be, for example, if we identify one task, how the user would perform that task with the system. So that will be a collaboration task. And we shall see one example soon. Implementation view, we can discuss it by the source files, the binary files, because this is where the implementation, the developing the system. So if I'm using Java language or Python, the source file of it will be in again the form of English. Now, if we compile this program, it will turn to a binary file or machine language. And if we run it, finish, it will be executable file, which we can use to do our job. Then we also have the process view, which is based on the process and thread. Normally, in operating system or in general computer science, a process is a task that is being executed. So if I have a task to withdraw money from ATM machine, if the task is not yet performed, we call it task. But when the task is being executed, we call it process. And normally a process may have one process may have one or more threads. So a thread will be a mini process. For example, to do one thing, maybe I have to do three or four things in order to accomplish a process. So that's a thread. Then we have the deployment view, which in this case will be mostly the nodes. So use case view first. Actually, we saw the use case view in the middle. The use case view is very important. This is the design to show how users interact with the system. So here we say a use case view contains only architecturally significant use cases. Use cases will be the tasks of the system. Whereas the final use case model contains all the use cases. So for example, the logical view is derived using the use cases, identifying the architectural view of the use case model. Also, the architectural significant use cases, this is very critical use cases, those that are most important to the users of the system. For example, an ATM machine, critical use cases can be withdrawing money, even depositing money can be again. And the use cases that carry the major risk. Use cases that have most important quality requirements, such as performance, security, and usability. These are all called a significant use cases. Again, ATM machine withdrawing, depositing. These are the two major, I would say, significant use case. Maybe checking your bank account depends. It can be a banking balance, can also be, or transferring also can be. So this example of a use case view of ATM machine. So here we have ATM system. As we said, think about what kind of different categories of users can use the system. So with ATM machine, employee can use the system, customer can use the system. But we have two types of customers: customers living in the country or customers overseas. So we have foreign customers and the customers. The two of them are bank customers. Then we have the bank offices. So a bank customer can deposit money, can transfer. Before transfer, we have to do validations and check the query. Withdraw also the same. When you are depositing, we don't care how much money you have in your account. So maybe we don't need to validate. It depends on the bank principles. But when you want to transfer money from one account to another, or you want to withdraw money, or you set a query to do something, then we need to validate. The system have to validate you if you have enough balance to do that. So if the validation have an error, we have a handling exception. Handling exception is in a programming system. When a program is running, or in this case, the system is running, if there is an error, instead of the system to stop working, we can throw the error away. So we use the exception handling. Exception in computer programming means an error when the program is executing, the error that it creates. We also need to check the PIN, etc. Now, with the bank officer, he can advertise in ATM. He can collect the data by the ATM usage or statistics. He can also maintain the ATM, but customers cannot maintain the ATM. So next week, the logical view, we say logical view is the subset of the design model, which represent architecturally significant design element. And we said the logical view can be a class diagram, collaboration, and also the interface. So these diagrams normally would describe the most important classes, the organization packages, and subsystems. And the packages, again, are special classes that come with the software programming, the programming language. The organization of these packages and subsystems into layers. Also, it describes the most important use case realization. For example, we have a dynamic aspect of the architecture. So this is a logical view for class diagram. As we said in our assignment, you can have use case diagram and class diagram. Also, we already have another video which I sent the link already about activity diagrams and other UML diagrams. You can select any of the two. So with the class diagram here, we have, this is for ATM machine. So you can see that we have a diagram for dispenser to dispense money. We need authorization first. So any class diagram may have two items: the characteristics of the class diagram, which will be mostly instant variables, and the behavior will be the method. So here we can see authorize dispense. We have open and close parentheses, which means this is a method belonging to the class name dispenser. We also have the withdrawal service class. In this case, we didn't want to add the instant variables and the characteristics. We just had the methods for each class. So for example, in account, what are the behavior of account? We can validate if the account is correct. We can deposit money in the account. We can transfer money into the account. We can withdraw, or we can even transfer from the account. Then we have a transfer service. Transfer service, we can't deposit or withdraw, so we can only request transfer. Deposit service, we can either request deposit or money reception. So this example of a class diagram for ATM machine. Then next we have the collaboration diagram deposit. Now collaboration, we said how the user collaborate or work with the system. So for example, here we have a customer. The customer, first of all, have to identify itself, number one. This is for ATM machine. So you go to the cashier interface. Then next, after he identifies himself here, there will be a PIN. You have to enter his username or the PIN number, etc., to validate it. Now, next, everything went fine. Step one to identify. Next step is to request withdrawal. So the class diagram withdrawal service will take care of that. So first, again, we need to validate and then withdraw it, validate his account before he can do the withdrawal. So if it's correct validation for withdrawing, then we give authorized dispenser to come up with the to dispense the money. Then the money is sent to the customer. So a collaboration diagram basically tells us how user interact with the system and how the system accomplish the tasks the user requested for. So we also have the logical view. This is a package diagram. Here we show all the possible packages for, in this case, withdrawal and transfers. We also have the process view. The process view normally consists of the processes and thread. As we said, process are the tasks that is being running. And every process can have threads, one or more threads. So process and thread are the same. They form the subsystem concurrency and synchronization mechanism. Sometimes we may have one process, may have two threads, and these two threads can work at the same time, can perform their tasks at the same time. So the synchronization issue comes in, or maybe one task has to be performed before the other. We also have the deployment view. This session can describe one or more physical network. So here to look like the general layout of the computers and the hardware in the company, the configuration also. Then we have implementation view. This is where we are concerned with the source code. For example, if I'm using Java language, I'll write the source code, the files that I need, the executable file or documentation, etc. So implementation view will describe the organization of static software modules. Modules can be subset of the code, the program language. And our model using the UML component diagrams. So before we start implementing a system, we should have the model, which is part of software architectural view. So UML diagram components are physical and replaceable part of a system that confine to and also provide realization of a set of interfaces. So this example of a UML 2.0, right now I think we are around 3.0, 4.0. These are the 13 possible diagrams. From structure diagrams here, we have class diagram, components diagram, deployment diagram, composite diagram, object diagram, and package diagram. Now with the behavior section, we have activity diagram. So you can see the structure diagram basically will be a diagram by the system structures, like a class, component, deployment. Now, with the behavior, we can say, okay, a use case diagram, how user interact with the system. We also should have the activity diagram here, all the tasks the system have to perform. And also we have state machine diagram, etc. So that will be the conclusion of our lectures. Again, these lectures focus on Unit 3 of our course, which is based on modeling, or we use the term software architectural view. So again, wish everybody the best and thank you for your time.